Hello, my name is Adam Kurtz, and my partners for this presentation are David Schroeder and Toby Ferguson, and we will be explaining to you OLED screens. Here, we have some of the materials needed to be produced in OLED screens. First are nanotubes. Nanotubes are allotropes of carbon with a cylindrical nanostructure. Next, you will need a layer of organic material, such as p-phenylene vinylene. Some can have multiple layers to improve efficiency or conductivity. Finally, a transparent electrical conductive material that would make up the anodes. An example of this would be indium tin oxide. Here, we have some of the pictures of what the materials look like. To the left, you can see indium tin oxide in its powder form, and to the right, you can see the atomic structure of what carbon nanotubes look like. Here, we have the physics and working principles of OLED screens. First, you can see the equation E equals F times V, where E is the energy of a particle of light, F is a constant, and V is the frequency of the light. During operation, a voltage is applied across the OLED screen such that the anode is positive with respect to the cathode. As the current flows from the cathode to the anode, electrons are injected into the lowest unoccupied molecular orbitals and withdrawn from the highest occupied molecular orbital. Electrostatic forces bring the electrons towards each other and they recombine to form an exciton. An exciton is a bound state of an electron and an electron hole caused by electrostatic forces. The decay of the excited state will result in the relaxation of energy levels of the electron states, accompanied by the emission of radiation whose frequency is in the visible region. To get a better picture, here we have light going through the multiple layers of organic material and through the cathode and the anode through a specific frequency, V. Here we have a YouTube video that describes the production of OLED screens.
Phosphorescent emitters, you know, the secret ingredient that goes into the sauce. We also sell those to our manufacturing partners.
Now, each of those vials, how much could you get for that?
Dollars I can't tell you, but I can tell you a lot. I can tell you what's in there. It could buy a lot of people a starter house. And that would make lots and lots and lots, thousands of displays.
Where we prepare the glass substrates.
And you said a class 100 clean room. I just feel very clean.
Inside here is slightly positive pressure.
Two of our VTE systems, and you can actually kind of get a sense if you look inside, back from there, nothing's being grown right now, but that's a VTE system. Physically, we'll pick the glass up in here and then move it to various locations so it's on. So this is actually a system which feeds the epoxy bead around the perimeter of the display to do then pick and place the glass slip to put on top of it. So this is a semi-automatic system.
Semi-auto. So this is the system you use to print on plastic and metal foil?
Primarily today metal foil, but yes, it could be used for plastic as well.
Well, in the center, this is what we call our organic garden. It's showing a number of the colors that, depending on which one of our chemicals you use, can give you different colors. So there are deep blues, lighter blues, a whole range.
Here, we have the modern cost to produce an OLED screen. First, we have indium tin oxide powder, which is $176 per 1 kilogram, and nanotubes, which come out to be $250,000 for 1 kilogram. Here we have the social outcome for OLED screens. This innovation has made TV screens and cell phones much thinner and made them much clearer to read and operate. This is a rather new sort of technology, so the outcomes from this product are still being discovered today. Here, we have a visual representation of what an LCD and OLED screen would look like. As you can see, the main difference is the OLED screen has a much clearer picture because it has the truest blacks. The main difference between an LCD screen or LED and an OLED screen is that the OLED is thinner and produces a better picture than the LCD. Below is a YouTube video describing the differences between an LED and an OLED screen.
Thank you for watching, liking, commenting, sharing, and subscribing right now.
LED versus OLED. Go.
So OLED is organic LED. So my Samsung Galaxy phone uses an OLED. And instead of having a light source behind an LCD, the light source is the LED and the LED changes colors. The advantage of this is that if you want true black, you just don't light up the LED at all and you get no light. So it's very, very black. This is the technology, quote unquote, of the future. I mean, this is the giving you the best video quality, the best image quality, the best contrast ratios, all of those things. The problem is, it is very expensive to produce. You know, a regular LED display lights up a liquid crystal display, and that's a old technology. I mean, LCDs have been around for a very long time. OLED, where you're changing the color of the LED and you're doing those things, gives you the most dynamic color range in terms of contrast and brightness. But there are limitations. You know, your Samsung phone, or my Samsung phone, is still very hard to see in broad daylight because the LEDs aren't that bright in an OLED display. So they don't work very well in broad daylight.
Which is good in Seattle because we don't have a lot of daylight.
There's also certain parts of the color spectrum that are very hard to create on an OLED display.
Purple?
It is. It's the blues that are very hard. And so...
I was close. Indigo, purple, blue.
So the technology for LEDs to be red and green have been around for a very long time. And I, you know, if you remember, there's this big movement towards LED flashlights and LED lighting. And white LEDs are very new. We didn't have those as kids.
I mean, we didn't? I don't know. I mean, it's been a while since I was a kid, but I guess LEDs seem so new.
We all remember red LEDs on all sorts of
things. Yeah, like the game components.
Right.
Yeah.
There was red LEDs for a very long time. And then in the late 80s, they figured out how to make green LEDs. And then it was a big deal in the 90s that they figured out how to make blue LEDs. And white LEDs are a combination of the three.
Right.
Or at least that's where they originally were. Now we make blue LEDs that are basically just hyper blue.
So organic is the way of the future.
OLED is the way of the future. It's still very expensive. There are still issues with how bright you can make it, but OLED gives you the best dynamic contrast and gives you the ability to have the highest resolution possible because you can make those much, much smaller. And because you're not dependent on the light source being independent of the color, you can make it so that the resolution is 1-to-1. Normally, you know, with an LED display, a single LED may light up a 4x4 grid of pixels, and so it may be responsible for 16 pixels.
Here, we have the change over time. In the 1950s, the first observations of electroluminescence in organic material was discovered by André Bernanos. In 1960, Martin Pope developed the OHMIC dark injecting electrode contacts into the organic crystals. They discovered the work functions for hole and electron functions. In 1987, Ching W. Tang developed the first light-emitting diode. As for what is happening currently, We will just have to wait and see what the next big thing will be. Listed below are the three inventors previously mentioned, Andre Bernanos, Martin Pope, and Qingdewu Tang. Here are some of the disadvantages of OLED screens compared to that of LED and LCD screens. The lifespan of these organic materials is not the best. After 1,000 hours, the blue luminance degraded by 12%, red by 7%, and green by 8%, which is considerably faster degrading than regular LED and LCD screens. Since blue degrades more quickly, the color balance is off between these three colors. Another key factor would be water abuse to these screens. And finally, power consumption. All the darker images consume only 40% of LCD. They consume three times as much in white images as opposed to LCD. Some improvements for these screens would be to improve the lifespan of organic materials in the screen's production, to decrease the power consumption in wider images, and to improve the color balance for the screens to have a better overall picture. I would like to thank you all for taking the time to view our presentation and hope that you realize that OLED screens are the future.